Clap going. Come on, let's give it a little bit. There we go. All right. Hey, we're glad you're here. We're excited you're here today. Go ahead and stand to your feet, if you would. Just want to take a moment to welcome each of you. If you're joining us online, a welcome to you. As well, out in the cafe, there's some coffee, bagels, donuts. Feel free to grab yourself something and bring it in here and hope that you just experience God today in an amazing way. If you're visiting with us, we'd love to know you're with us. In the little handout you received, there's a little connection card. Takes a moment to fill that out. You can drop that off at the Connection Center out there in the cafe area. Take a moment and greet somebody. We'll get going in just a moment. Hey.
With us, with the Jesus. creator, friend of mine.
Beautiful,
beautiful Jesus.
Join me as I read Psalms 47. Come, everyone, clap your hands and shout to God with joyful praise. For the Lord Most High is awesome. He is the great King of all the earth. He subdues the nations before us, putting our enemies beneath our feet. He chose the promised land as our inheritance, the proud possession of Jacob's descendants, whom he loves. God has ascended with a mighty shout. The Lord has ascended with trumpets blaring, singing praises to our God. Sing praises. Sing praises to our King. Sing praises. For God is the King over all the earth. Praise Him with a song. Sing at your name.
At your name. The mountains shake and crumble. Your name, the oceans roar and tumble.
It's your name,
at your name, the angels bow, the earth will rejoice, your people cry out. Lord, all the earth, we shout your name, shout your name. In His praise, in His praise. Yahweh, Yahweh, we love to shout your name.
yours forever. You are my strength, God of grace and power. And everything you hold in your hand, still you make time for me. I can't understand. You got the earth and sky, beautiful. Sure, I'm fair enough. And you never change, God. You remain the Holy One. And I'm fair enough.
To what you have for us this morning. Go with us and guide us throughout the rest of this service, Lord. And it's in your son's name we have the privilege to pray. Amen.
Amen. All right. Well, you guys are grabbing your seats. I'm going to tell you guys a little story. Kind of goes right along with our story series. I want to share with you the story of one man that I encountered about 3 years ago on South Glenstone in Springfield. One encounter with one man and one man's story that dramatically changed my life from that moment forward. And that encounter has given me a deep, deep passion for not only taking the time in my life to see other people and to hear other people's stories, but it's also given me a deep passion to share this crazy story and hope that it challenges you too. So this is kind of what happened. I vividly remember it was spring about 3 years ago, and I remember it was spring because I was coming out of hibernation. I don't like cold weather. If you know me, you know that. And so I distinctly remember it being a warm morning, and I thought, I'm going to go to the park over by the Nature Center, and I'm going to take my Bible, I'm going to take my prayer journal. At the time, I was reading Mark Batterson's The Circle Maker for like the 15th time, and I was just going to go. I was going to spend a few hours that morning at the park just reading and spending some time with God and enjoying sunshine again. And so I was there at the park, and I was reading Batterson's book, and just took a lot of time to pray some big circle prayers in my life. We were praying some big breakthroughs in our personal life, for family. We were praying some big breakthroughs for church. We were praying big breakthroughs around Lead Her at that time. And I remember I thought, you know what? How have I never thought of this before? I'm going to go to Staples, and I'm going to get a big poster board, and I'm going to draw a giant circle on it, and I'm going to write all these big circle prayers. I'm going to hang it in my bedroom where I can see it every morning. And it just reminds me of all these big things that I'm praying for. Great idea, right? So jumped in the car, looked at my watch. John shared last week he doesn't like to be late to anything. You and I, so much alike. Because if I'm 15 minutes, you know, more than 15 minutes early, then I'm in trouble. Because I really, really like to be at least 15 minutes early. Looked at my watch. I was meeting a friend for lunch that day at the Applebee's there on South Glenstone. And I thought, I've got just enough time that I can stop, run in, grab a poster board, still be there early, and have no problem. So anyway, jump in my car, and I'm in the far lane so that I can turn on Independence. And I look over, and on the on-ramp coming onto Glenstone off of James River, there was a man and a woman standing there holding a cardboard sign. And I'd seen that so many times. We've all seen that, right? Right there at that particular place tend to be a lot of those kind of people holding that sign from time to time. But for some reason, this day and that couple, I couldn't stop staring at them. And all of a sudden, I realized they were staring back at me. At least it felt like they were. I remember that man had bright blue eyes, and they seemed to literally penetrate my soul. And I just couldn't shake that look, that connection that we made for a minute. And I quickly tried to kind of look away. The light turned green, and I kept going. Got to Staples, pulled in the parking lot, started to get out of my car, and I just was overwhelmed. I had this huge burden at that moment, and I literally felt like it's one of the very few times in my life that I felt like God was speaking to me very, very clearly and very, very directly. And I felt like he said, really? Really? You're going to go, and you're going to get this piece of poster board to write these big circle prayers that you want me to answer in your life, but you're not even willing to step outside of yourself and do the little things for other people? And I was like completely convicted, and I thought, okay, what do you want me to do? Feed them. Feed them. Okay. Looked at my watch because I didn't want to be late. Here's the second part of this story. I also remember that it was on the 19th of the month. And here's how I remember that. Because payday was the 20th. And I was a really good budgeter. Still am. And had budgeted just enough to stretch our checking account until the 20th. So I literally believed that I had $3 in cash on me. And that's it. That's okay, there was stuff for dinner that night, and there was gas in the car, and everything was going to be fine, but there just wasn't any extra that day. And I thought, okay, first of all, I'm going to be late. Second of all, I don't have the money to feed them. And so I looked across the parking lot, and there's McDonald's right there. And I thought, okay, I can do this really quick. I'll go and I'll grab two double cheeseburgers off the dollar menu, take them back to him, and then still make it to my appointment. I'll still be about 5 minutes early. Pulled into McDonald's. Couldn't shake the feeling that something still wasn't right. And the lady said, can I take your order? And I said, no, I don't think so. And I pulled out, and I'm like, what am I don't understand. I'm feeding them. Okay, I acknowledge that the next part sounds kind of crazy. But this is the moment where I said, what do you want me to do? And I literally felt like God said something that didn't make any sense in that moment. Never heard God talk about food, just so you know, this was the only time. But this is the word that I heard, lasagna. Lasagna. What? And I looked, next door was a Fazoli's. And I thought, okay, lasagna. I definitely don't have time for that, and I know $3 will not buy two lasagnas at Fazoli's. But nonetheless, I couldn't shake this feeling that I was supposed to order lasagna. So I pulled out of McDonald's, pulled into Fazoli's, got up to the thing, and the lady said, can I take your order? And I said, I think so. She said, you think so? And I said, yeah, I think so. And she said, okay. And I said, I think that I need two lasagnas. And she said, okay, that'll be $9.67. And I said, yep, that's what I thought. Okay. And so two cars ahead of me, I had some time to pray. And I thought, what in the world am I supposed to do? I'm holding $3 in my hand. I'm looking at my watch. I didn't know what to do. And all of a sudden, I remembered that Bob, we don't spend, we don't use credit cards. So everything we do is in cash. And so he at the time was collecting change. And he was collecting it in the van. And he'd keep it in this little compartment. I was like, oh, his change jar. I can raid that. So I dump it out. Anyone want to guess how much change is in that change jar? $6.97. The exact amount that I needed to finish paying for those lasagnas. So I pulled up to the window. I apologized for handing her an enormous amount of nickels and pennies. She handed me 2 lasagnas and I drove back. And I thought, okay, this is going to be simple. I'll hand him the lasagnas. He'll say, wow, I'm so lucky. I've been craving lasagnas for months. This will be great. And he'll just praise God and it'll be wonderful. I'll go to my meeting. Didn't happen. Drove to the stoplight. He was gone. And I'm like, you have to be kidding me. What in the world? And so I kind of look both directions and there I see him. He's trucking it down Glenstone. I'm like, okay, I can catch him. I can cut him off. It won't scare him at all. And so I make a sharp turn, peel out, cut him off at a side road, roll down my window, and I was like, hey, come here a second. He looked at me like I was crazy, which is probably well-deserved. And what happened next, I think, will never, ever, ever leave me. He walked up to my window, passenger side, and he said, what do you want? And I said, hey, you know, I was just driving by a few minutes ago. I saw you and your friend. And he cut me off. That was not my friend. Okay. Well, I saw you and that other person standing there, and I just felt really prompted to get you some lunch. And he's like, you're one of those people, aren't you? And I thought, one of those people? What are you talking about? He said, you're one of those Christian people. And he said it like it was a dirty word. And I remember that so vividly because it was the first time in my entire life that anyone ever looked at me with disdain because the term Christian applied to me. Now, I wasn't the smartest person in that moment because I thought, yeah, I absolutely am. You know, I'm thinking, do you want to hear about Jesus too? And he thought, I hate all of you. That was his response. And I just kind of went to him and he said, I'm so sick of seeing you people. You go to your fancy churches and you drive your fancy cars and you wear your fancy clothes, but you don't see us. And he said, what would you do if I showed up in your church? What would you do if I was stinky and I was smelly and I didn't have all the right stuff and I didn't know the right words? He just went on and on. He is screaming at me in my window on the side of Glenstone. And in my mind, I'm thinking, God, what is happening? What am I supposed to do here? And all of a sudden, he said, I don't want you. I don't want your Jesus. I don't want your food. I don't need your charity. And he started to walk off. It would have been really easy in that moment for me to have gone, okay, we're going to have a picnic in the car with lasagnas instead of Applebee's. But I couldn't do that. Something inside of me knew that there was more to that story. And so I cried out and I said, wait, please don't go. Come back. And he turned around and he said, what? And I mean, he was just red. He was boiling angry. And I said, I am so sorry. I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry. For every Christian that you have ever encountered that looked at you like you weren't there. And I am so sorry for every time that you experienced that, because that's not the heart of Daddy God. And I'm sorry for myself because I know I've done it. And it might not have been to you, but I apologize to you. And he just stared at me for a minute, and I didn't know what else to say. And all of a sudden he said, what'd you say you brought me? And I said, lasagna. And he looked at me. There wasn't a, oh my gosh, I've been craving lasagna for months. He said, did you get me any water? And I looked down, and I just happened to have 2 brand new, unopened bottles of water in the floorboard of the van. And I handed it to him. There was no thank you. There was no, wow, I've waited my whole life to hear a Christian apologize to me. There was nothing. He turned around and he left. And that was it. I sat there probably for 2 or 3 minutes on the side of that road, just shaking. My hands just shook. And I didn't know what to say. And to be really honest, I was a little angry. Because I had this moment with God where I remember saying to him, what the heck was that? What was that? I literally just gave everything that I had. Everything. My time, my money, my everything. I gave everything. My dignity. I gave everything to this man who was ungrateful and could care less. Now you know how I feel, Christine. forget hearing that. It penetrated my soul because I thought, man, how many times do we do that? How many times do we do that? How many times does God give us everything? He gave us His Son. He gave us abilities. He gave us talents. And how many times do we act like we're ungrateful? That day became a catalyst for me. That day became a catalyst for me because it made me realize that though I had claimed to be a believer since I was 7 years old, though I was working in full-time ministry, though that a lot of my free time at the park was spent reading God's word, I still had an incredibly cold, stubborn, me-centered, Christy-focused heart. That a lot of times I didn't want to stop for other people because I had places to be and I had things that I had to do. I had other ways that I wanted to spend my money, and I'm being completely transparent. I was convicted in that moment of just how cold and stubborn I must look to people. Spent a lot of time after that day processing, praying. And I came across this verse I want to share with you. It's from Ezekiel chapter 36, verses 26 and 27. It says this, "And I will give you a new heart, and I will put a new spirit in you, and I will take out your stony, stubborn heart, and I will give you a tender, responsive heart. And I will put my spirit in you so that you will follow my decrees and be careful to obey my regulations." I grabbed a hold of that verse with both hands, and I made that my prayer. God, break my heart for the things that break yours. God, open my eyes to see people the way that you see people. God, take this cold, stubborn, Christy-focused heart and replace it with one that is cold, that is warm and is responsive. And it wants to not only see people, but it wants to be motivated to act. That day really became a moment for me that I can look back and see where something literally broke and something literally changed. That was the day where I really believe that God birthed in me a passion for other people's stories. It's not just about me anymore. And I had to come to that place where I had to realize that. And we all have to come to that place. It was shortly after that encounter that I was doing my quiet time. And I came across this. Ephesians 5:1 says, "Imitate God, therefore, in everything you do, because you are His dear children." It doesn't suggest that we imitate God. Paul is mandating believers to imitate our Heavenly Father. Our Heavenly Father. We are called to imitate a God who loves us, a God who forgives us, a God who is there for us, a God who provides for us. We are called to imitate that God. But we're also called to imitate a God that we see in Genesis chapter 16. That story of Hagar, when Sarah and Abraham have been promised a son, and it's not happening, and they're in their old age, and it's not happening, and Sarah decides to take matters into her own hands. And she says to Abraham, "Here, take my slave girl, Hagar, sleep with her, and she can give you a son, and maybe that will be the way that God fulfills this promise." So that happens, and Hagar gives him Ishmael. And it wasn't shortly after that that Sarah began to mistreat Hagar. And so Hagar took baby Ishmael, and she ran out into the wilderness. She eventually placed him under a bush, some protection, while she lay down pretty much expecting to die. And at that moment, an angel of the Lord appears to her and says, "What are you doing? What are you doing? Get up and go back. Get up and go back." And she becomes the first person, male or female, in Scripture to give God a name. And here's what she calls him. In verse 13, she says, "You are the God who sees me." We are called to imitate our Heavenly Father. We are called to imitate a God who sees. So many times, you and I, we're not seeing. We're intentionally turning a blind eye to other people because of our schedules, because of our time, because of our resources. You know, a few years ago, Brandon Heath came out with a song that, man, if you listen to the words of that song, it will rock you. I'm not going to sing for you, but I'm going to tell you, here's what the chorus says. Says, "Give me your eyes for just 1 second. Give me your eyes so I can see everything that I keep missing. Give me your love for humanity. Give me your arms for the brokenhearted, the ones that are far beyond my reach. Give me your heart for the ones forgotten. Give me your eyes so I can see." So here's a question that I have for you. We're going to watch a video that we were able to make with the help of some really amazing and super gifted people here at Northbridge. you're going to hear a spoken word poem in this video by Grant Hartley. And I was able to have coffee with Grant and just share with him this story and just this message and just my heart for challenging us to be willing to see other people around us. And this is what Grant came up with. But as you watch this, as you listen to him, as you see these images that Travis and Chris took, as we just went around Springfield, a couple of days, just everyday life in Springfield, these are people you might encounter anytime, any day, as you just go through your regular life. I want you to ask yourself this question and just think about this over the next 4 minutes. How different would this city start to look if we made that prayer our own? Watch this video for a second.
I have come to believe that our minds are college ruled, that the substance of our synapses and heartbeats is something like paper, that the human condition is such that we are all writing our lives out as poetry in ink the color of the sky, that one poem, like one cell, makes up a life and is a life, and the great expanse of time is a library or an anthology of souls.
Give me your eyes for just 1 second. Give me your eyes so I can see everything that I keep missing. Give me your love for humanity. Give me your arms for the brokenhearted, the ones that are far beyond my reach. Give me your heart for the ones who got it. Give me your eyes so I can see.
That for our entire lives, ink is all we are given. One pen and an ever-changing shade of blue for keeping a record, and one in crimson for searing remembrance, or for some, atonement. That we are given ink, not lead, and no eraser, no way to forget save perhaps misplacing the pages in passing time. That life happens in rough draft, and redemption will edit, will more than undo every jagged red line.
Give me your eyes for just 1 second. Give me your eyes so I can see everything that I keep missing. Give me your love for humanity. Give me your arms for the brokenhearted, ones that are far beyond my reach. Give me your heart for the ones who got it. Give me your eyes so I can see.
That brokenness, like a line break, can be more than a mistake, will be more, will be beautiful. That the power of the written word is in the writing as well as the reading. That the power of the spoken word is in the speaking as well as the listening. That there is power at both ends of confession, and seeing and being seen. Power in open closet doors and the open arms in which light blind friends may find rest. That we are icons. Avatars, image bearers, called to respond to every wilderness story ending in a question mark with love like angels.
Give me your eyes for just 1 second. Give me your eyes so I can see everything that I keep missing. Give me your love for humanity. Give me your arms for the brokenhearted, the ones that are far beyond my reach. Give me your heart for the ones who got it. Give me your eyes so I can see.
Different could it be? And how different could it look? You know, I shared with you Ephesians 5:1 tells us that we are called to imitate God. But verse 2, Paul goes on to tell us this. He says, live a life filled with love, following the example of Christ. He loved us. He offered himself as a sacrifice for us.
a pleasing aroma to God. Yesterday was Valentine's Day. And I got to tell you, in the immense scope of history, I don't think there's ever been any greater act of love than what Christ did for us on Calvary. He came and he laid down his life. And you've got to come back next week and hear the rest of that story, because that's what we're going to finish this series out with, is talking about God's story and his love story for us. But you've got to understand this piece. He sacrificed. He sacrificed his body, his life, for you and for I. And here's the problem. We are called to mandate that kind of sacrifice. Very seldom in our Western world here in Springfield are we going to be asked to lay down our life for that. But we are asked to lay down our time. We might be asked to lay down our resources. We might be asked to lay down our comfort level for just a little bit and be willing to divert away from our schedule and our focus that is so in tune with what's best for me. Where do I have to get? How do I want to spend those last $3? We have to be willing to imitate in those moments that kind of sacrifice. You know, I told you at the beginning that after I had that encounter with that man, I started to pray, God, break my heart for the things that break yours. Here's the thing, though. I have come to realize over the last few years as I have continued to pray that prayer, that if our hearts don't break for the things that break God's heart, then we need to seriously look to see if there's a connection problem there. Because if we as believers can just cold, drive by people in need, walk by people in need, do life with people in need every single day, and never take time to see, to respond, to do something, then there's a connection problem here. And that's the thing we've got to address. Because being willing to hear their stories is what earns us the ability to share ours and what earns us the right to share God's story. We have to start with the willingness to take some time and say, hey, let's grab a cup of coffee. I just want to hear your story. You know, I think so many times we hear that big word evangelism and we get so scared, we get so intimidated, and we think that's something that only ministers and people in full-time ministry and pastors do. No. That's something that we are all called to do. Imitate God. See people. Meet people. Love people. That's something that's mandated for all believers. And here's the thing. I think so many times we're afraid to hear other people's stories because we're not sure how to respond to other people's stories. We're not sure what might come next. We're not sure if we know all the right verses to quote or where to find all the right answers or who do we connect them to. Okay, I'm going to make this super, super simple for you. This is really evangelism in a nutshell. It's three things, okay? It's number one, seeing. It's seeing. Seeing with his eyes, like we just talked about in that video. It's being willing to say, I don't want to see people through my schedule and my resources and what makes sense in my mind. I want to see people, God, through your eyes and your heart. Seeing people is number one. Number two is listening, engaging, asking. It's saying, hey, share your story with me. It's saying, hey, I'd like to know a little bit more about you. Can we grab coffee sometime? It's taking the time to listen. That's all it is. And then number three is responding. It's responding. Sometimes that response is going to be, man, I need to connect you to so-and-so because you would really appreciate their story, and I think they've got something they could really share with you. It might be, you know what? I've been through this myself. Can I share my story with you? It may be, hey, I would love, if you're not busy on Sunday, can you come with me to church? There's a plethora of ways that you can respond. Sometimes that might be, you know what? I see that you have a need, a practical need, and I want to help you meet that need. I want to activate people around me to help you meet that need. Sometimes that response isn't cookie cutter. Let me rephrase that. Never is that response cookie cutter. Every single time that you sit down with a different person, they're going to have different needs, and they're going to need a different response from you. But if you are willing to see them, you are willing to listen to them, and then you are willing to respond in love, as we're called in Ephesians 5:2 to do, imagine the difference. That's evangelism. That's all there is to it. Because when you build a relationship with someone, when you do that, you earn the right to speak into them. You earn the ability to share truth with them. You earn the right to say, hey, can I pray with you? I know that you might not really believe in that, but I do, and I believe that my God's a big God, And I believe that he can take care of my problems as well as yours. It earns that right for us when we are willing to listen. You know, a lot of times I think that we get this misconception that when we connect with people and we hear their stories, it's just for their benefit. It's just so that we can do something to them. We can meet their need. We can lead them to Christ. We can tell them God's story. We can get them to church. But let me tell you something. It benefits you as well. I was thinking about this last night. My daughter has a cold, and so she was up in the middle of the night last night, and I was awake and kind of praying and processing for this morning. Pretty sure that that was a God thing, because I just needed some more time to think through that. And I started to just really reflect on how many times has my life been impacted? How have I benefited from getting to hear some of those stories that I've gotten to hear over the last 3 years as I've made this more of a focus for myself? So here's three. I jotted them down since it was 3 a.m. Number one, when I'm willing to listen to other people's stories, it reminds me every single time that nobody's perfect. Nobody's perfect. Everybody's got stuff. Everybody's got issues. And every time that I sit across from someone, I don't care if they are a drug addict, if they are a prostitute, if they are a CEO, I don't care who they are or what they are. Every single person has something, right? And it reminds me, every time that I do that, it reminds me, number one, God is big enough for whatever my problems are. But it also reminds me, there is no problem that can sit across from me with a cup of coffee. And that problem is too big for my God. And I need to be reminded of that. The other thing that it does for me is just like we talked about, God sees them, God sees us too. And I cannot tell you how many times since I've really, really tried to be more intentional about hearing other people's stories, do I go into a meeting or do I just run into someone and have a conversation where I feel like I'm the one who just got ministered to? Because I hear their story and it reminds me that God sees me too. It reminds me that he loves me, he forgives me, and I need that fresh reminder again and again and again. Here's the last one. Every time that I listen to someone's story, every time that I'm willing to put aside my schedule and take some time to invest in other people, I get perspective. I get a mentality change. This goes for everyone. It goes for strangers, and it goes for close family and friends. If you're a parent out there, here's something that I started doing right after that encounter with a man on the street. My kids are small. We're 12, we're 11, and we're 9. But I started asking them, how can I pray for you today? I realized I'd never asked them that before. How can I be praying for you today? What are you facing today? What's going on in your world today? Because a lot of times I was just praying my checklist for them. Get into a good college, get a good job, meet a great spouse. But you know what? I will never forget. I asked Bryson one day, how can I be praying for you? And Bryson said, you know, there's this little boy in my class and he doesn't go to church. And I really want to tell him about Jesus, but I'm kind of afraid to do that. So could you pray with me that one, I'll be bold enough to do that, and two, that I'll know what to say? I would have missed that. I would have missed that. And so I got this cool opportunity over the weeks to pray individually for this kid. And then as I would go up and I'd have lunch with Bryson and we'd sit with Mason and we'd build this relationship. And I will never forget, on his field trip, I got to take a picture of Bryson praying with his friend. Okay, fourth grade. I would have missed that. Ask your kids, what are you facing? Tell me your story. How can I be praying for you? Do the same thing with your family. My dad lives in Colorado. To me, it's really sad that I waited until I was in my 30s to start saying to him, how can I be praying for you? What are you facing right now? Man, there have been some amazing conversations with him that I would have never had because I was too self-centered and just praying, okay, protect him, help him to have a good day, keep him healthy. But man, when I was willing to ask, my grandmother's in her 80s, I started this year saying, okay, once a month, we're going to go out to lunch, we're going to do a movie night. I want to hear your story. Tell me about when you were a little girl. She's not going to be here forever. But I now know those stories that I can pass down. Coworkers, how many people do I just walk by every day? They're just there constantly. They're consistent. But what does it look like when I say, hey, I've never really heard your story. Can we have lunch sometime? I would love to hear your story. it changes everything. It alters your perspective, and it impacts your relationships with them. So hear my heart today. Hear my heart. That prayer, God, break my heart for the things that break yours. God, help me to see people through your eyes and your heart. That applies just as much to the people that live under your roof with you as it does to the man that's holding a sign on the corner. It doesn't matter what your relationship with them is today. What matters is your willingness to see them, to ask them, and to respond to them. Let's pray. Father God, it is so easy. It is so easy for us to become so focused on ourselves. It is so easy for us to forget that every single moment of every single day that you are putting people in our path, that you are putting people in front of us. And God, I just pray right now, Lord, that you will give us your eyes. God, I pray that you will give us your heart. God, I pray that you will give us your motivation. God, I pray that you will replace our cold, stubborn, stony hearts with a warm, tender, responsive heart, God, that longs to see people, that longs to see our kids and our spouse, our family, our friends, our coworkers, our neighbors, the people right here in this room with us, God, that we can see them not just as people who maybe have it all together, but God, as people who have a story, and that story may be much deeper and much bigger and much longer than we could ever imagine. God, I pray that you give us a chance in this next week to sit down with someone and say, hey, I want to hear your story. Because I believe that hearing your story is going to bless you in getting to share it, but it's also going to bless me. It's going to challenge me. And it's going to grow me. And I believe that in that connection, God, you're going to be glorified. God, I pray that you give us boldness. You give us courage, whether those are loved ones or those are complete strangers, God, that you prompt us to act. And that we would be willing to be obedient to those promptings. In your name we pray. Amen.
I invite you to stand to your feet and join us as we sing. You are all I need.
Wow, thank you, Christy, for that challenge. I'll tell you what, you know, here's what God was saying to me today is that there are people all around me every single day, people I work with, people I live with, that I need to hear their stories, and I need to ask them about their stories. And so thank you for that. And it's been a powerful 2 weeks. And again, next week we continue this series as we hear God's story. And I really do encourage you this week, be praying about if you have friends maybe that are just kind of still investigating that whole thing, that religious thing, the Jesus thing. I'm not sure about that. Invite them to come next week. Invite them to come, grab a cup of coffee, listen to a great band, and hear a cool story. And I guarantee you that God will speak into that. So hope you've been challenged today. A couple of announcements I need to let you be aware of. One, on the February the 28th, we have a serving project. We're going to continue finishing some of the things that we started at the Harmony House. That'll be from 8 a.m. to noon. If you can't be there right at 8, just come when you can be there, and we'll put you to work. And so that will be on the 28th, 8 a.m. to noon. Also, Lisa Hulbert wanted me just to remind you that she extended the week on the mission trip sign-up, so she really needs to know today and tomorrow if you are wanting to go on the mission trip to New York. It says in the bulletin, skilled people are wanted. That excludes me, all right? I can't tell the difference between a regular screwdriver and a Phillips head screwdriver, so I'm not in that, all right? But if you're a skilled individual and you can work, they need you. Be praying about that and sign up to go on that mission trip, okay? Also, I meant to say the sign up for the work day is out on the Connection Center, so you can sign up for that out there. Brandon Michelle Mailer, come on up here. If this couple looks familiar, they were a part of our GIC. Just stand right down here. They were a part of our GIC this last time. They've been coming to Northbridge for some time, and they came to our last Discovery Northbridge luncheon, and they have kind of been deciding and thinking about and praying about being a part of our church here, our membership, and so they have decided to go ahead and take that plunge, right? And that's right. And for the longest time, we've introduced them as the Mallers. And finally, at our Discovery Northbridge luncheon, they're such nice people, they never wanted to correct us. And they finally said, hey, it's Mailer. All right, so that's the Mailers. Come and welcome them, befriend them, be nice to them. All right? All right. God bless you. You guys are dismissed. You guys stay here. Yeah.